Please welcome the president and CEO of the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum, Natalie Shirley, and vice chairman of the board of directors, Jerry Winchester.
Oh my gosh, isn't this going to be fun tonight? This is just such a great thing. I am so glad you all are here. Good evening and welcome. Thank you so much for joining us on this exciting night as we honor those who elevate the untamed spirit of the Great West.
We're honored to have each of you with us here tonight to celebrate our 60th anniversary. And this momentous night would not have been possible without the generous support of our event sponsors and dedicated museum partners, whom we would like to recognize at this time.
Please hold your applause until all of the sponsors have been recognized. Thank you to the event sponsors, Arvest Bank, the Chickasaw Nation, the Cressup Family Foundation, Greg and Becky Kowalski, Lenny and Linda Sadler, and thanks to our museum partners, the Devon Energy Corporation, and the E.L. and Thelma Gaylord Foundation, and the True Foundation, whose support provides the museum with operating stability to continue its vital mission of preserving the art and the culture of the West. And thank you to the Wrangler Network for streaming again this year's awards on WranglerNetwork.com.
We're also grateful to our fellow board of directors members, specifically the Western Heritage Committee, for their leadership and support. Will the board of directors please stand to be recognized at this time?
We would also like to extend a warm welcome to the hardworking leaders of the many corridors of government in attendance this evening, namely Mayor David Holt and Rachel Holt, Oklahoma. All right, y'all, it's a long list, so just hold on until I get to the end of it. I'll give you the high sign when it's time. Oklahoma Lieutenant Governor Matt Pinnell and his wife, Lisa. Chickasaw Nation Governor Anna Tubby. Wyoming Governor Mark Gordon and First Lady Jenny Gordon, former Governor of Oklahoma Frank Keating and First Lady Kathy Keating, one of our board members, Oklahoma Secretary of Public Safety Tricia Everest, Wyoming State Senator Ogden and his wife Zanny Driscoll, and I'd like to extend a special welcome to the Wyoming Cheyenne Founders Day folks, so thank you for coming out today. And now, we invite you to please rise for the singing of the Canadian National Anthem, O Canada, by Stephanie James. Please remain standing for the singing of our National Anthem by 2019 New Horizons recipient, commonly known as the Buckaroo Girl, Adrian Brannon. And then our invocation, which will be delivered by two-time Western Heritage Award, Wrangler Award winner and board member and producer, Lincoln Lagesson.
Oh, Canada, our home and native land, true patriot love in all our sons command. With glowing hearts we see thee rise, the true north strong and free. From far and wide, O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. God keep our land glorious and free. Stand on guard for thee. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs burst. That our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave for the land of the free and the
Good evening. How wonderful it is for us to be together tonight in this beautiful room, in this grand building on this very special night. May we ask you to please remove your hats and bow your heads. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we have gathered here together tonight to celebrate our inductees and honorees. We give them thanks for them, for their families, and for those in attendance tonight. We also give thanks for the blessings of your holy presence throughout our lives, Father. May this evening celebrate you as well. Please help us reflect your creativity and love in our thoughts, our words, and our deeds. Please protect those in service both here at home and abroad. And finally, Father, may we ask you to protect the cowboys, for our world needs cowboys more now than ever before. Thank you, Father. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Aiden, Stephanie, and Lincoln. Our ceremony will begin shortly. In the meantime, please enjoy your dinner and the company at your table. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
please welcome to the stage past Wrangler Award winner and chairman of the Western Heritage Committee, Wyatt McCray.
Good evening. Once again, welcome to the 60th Annual Western Heritage Awards. It's hard to believe that it's been 2.5 years since we have graced this beautiful room for these historic awards. How great is it to be back? We all know how chaotic things seem to be these days, and we are so grateful to be here to celebrate the works of some very exceptional, talented, and hardworking individuals. As you can imagine, there have been a multitude of ups and downs, postponements, cancellations, as we have worked to put together the premier Western award show in the country. I want to recognize all the staff of the museum, my fellow committee members, the museum board, and everyone that has worked so hard to make this happen. A big thank you to all of you. Tonight is all about our honorees and inductees, and I have the very special privilege of introducing you to the man who is going to hitch up the horse to the cart and get us rolling. He and his family have been great friends to the museum for many, many years. His dad, James Paul Lynn, served as a member of the board of directors here for 25 years. Tonight marks his fifth, if you count the luncheon yesterday, as our master of ceremonies. And if you follow the news or social media at all, you know this son of a gun has a girlfriend that makes him look really good on karaoke night. And though he is somewhat follically challenged, he is a very accomplished actor who has brought some memorable characters to life in such great films as Wyatt Earp, Monty Walsh, for which he won a Wrangler Award, and Rush Hour. You can catch him on CBS's Young Sheldon, and he will be co-starring in the premiere of the upcoming final season of Better Call Saul, as well as the new limited series Roar with Nicole Kidman. And I hope he's still backstage because I know it's about time for his beloved Texas Longhorns to kick off. But anyway, ladies and gentlemen, the man also known as Sugar Tot in some circles, please give a big Western welcome to my good friend, Mr. Ray.
I just saw the broom, and I just thought, I don't know. It's the big 6-0, so why not? Welcome, everybody. I don't know what to do. Man, what a great crowd we have tonight. We got lots of pretty people in here. Lots of them. And really excited about having George Strait in the house tonight. Really, really excited about having Mr. Robert Duvall in the house tonight. And on a personal note, I'm always down there sitting down and Tater Tot McIntyre is always up here, so this feels pretty good. I want to say real quickly, before we get started, I want everybody to give a warm welcome to Nathan, the whole crew, Kayla, Becky, everybody, Natalie, everybody that's been working really hard, and all this wait staff. They put together a really amazing show, and they put two of them back to back. So thank you guys for that. You know, it's been 2 years since we've been here, and to quote my favorite songwriter, Don Henley of the Eagles, it's been a lot of things have happened since the last time we spoke. Some of them are funny and some of them ain't no joke. Frustrating is a kind word to describe almost every aspect of our current times, packed full of advancements in how we work, play, and innovate. These advancements that make our world almost fantastical also brings challenges. The complications of change, the constant new normal that often seems impossible to attain, and throw in a worldwide pandemic to keep things interesting. We are heartened by the guidance of our grand collective heritage gifted to us by those who penned their chapters before ours. These are the many diverse characters of a culture that lend voice and animus to the overwhelming beauty that is the great American West. Tonight we celebrate those who carved our heritage from the past and honor those who continue to embrace the brave ideals of Western culture and contribute to this incredible story. Now, the all too stale phrase, unprecedented times, seems to always follow disappointing cancellations we've all no doubt experienced over the last year. Due to the postponement of last year's awards, we were determined to honor all who deserve the distinction of recognition last year and this year, no matter what. This made the privilege of presenting the Western Heritage Award to the honorees for outstanding achievements in Western literature all the more sweeter yesterday afternoon in the first of two ceremonies we dutifully mounted this year. All those who were honored yesterday, if you don't mind, could you please stand up? These were all honored people that were honored yesterday at our ceremony. Thank you all for your contributions to the Western culture. Yesterday's truly outstanding honorees and tonight's inductees will receive the Wrangler, which is, of course, the impressive bronze statue created by the renowned artist Harold T. Holden. Absolutely. I've got one of them, but nobody ever believes it. They're like, what'd you get that for? They just don't believe me. Harold T. Holden, bestowed to those icons who continue our contribution to the Western narrative and preserve the spirit of the great American West. Assisting with presenting the Wranglers this evening are Miss Rodeo Oklahoma Colimars and Miss Rodeo Oklahoma Princess McKinley Bowers. Let's give them a big hand. I called them Miss Rodeo America in backstage, and they were quick to remind me that it was Miss Rodeo Oklahoma, and I said, well, you're on your way up, man. So they were happy about that. Before we continue, we'd like to honor two important women who are no longer with us, but their warm presence can still be felt. These women were both major supporters of this event as well as this museum. Let's hear more about their legacy. Take a look.
Jacqueline Jackie McIntyre was the matriarch of a close-knit southeastern Oklahoma ranch and rodeo family. A lifelong resident of Atoka County, Oklahoma, Jackie attended Limestone Gap, where she graduated in 1943 at the age of 16. She went on to attend Southeastern Oklahoma State College and lacked just a few hours to graduate. She received her honorary degree with her family by her side at the young age of 89. In 1950, she married future three-time world champion steer roper, Hall of Fame Western Heritage and Pro Rodeo Hall of Fame member Clark McIntyre. They had four children, Alice, Paik, Reba, and Susie, in 5 years. Jackie worked at the Kyle Law School to help out in building the family ranch. When she wasn't at the school, she spent her days working right alongside the men and her children on the ranch. Jackie was inducted into the Cowgirl Hall of Fame in 2019. Thanks to Jackie, all four children learned how to sing and help pass the time while traveling from rodeo to rodeo. Three of those kids continue to make a living in the music business. Jackie shared a writing credit on her daughter Reba McIntyre's 2017 gospel double album, Sing It Now, Songs of Faith and Hope. Jackie passed away at her home in Stringtown, Oklahoma on March 14, 2020. She left a host of memories for her children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, nieces, and nephews to cherish for many years to come. We are honored to celebrate another cowgirl whose life exemplifies the determination and inspiration that continues to shape the West. Sharon Heinlein Shoulders was born in 1929 in California. As a teenager, she moved to Tulsa, Oklahoma, and while attending high school, she met a boy named Jim Shoulders. She became the wife of the world-famous rodeo cowboy in September of 1947. She co-founded the Jim Shoulders Rodeo Company and ran the J. Lazy S. Ranch in Henrietta while Jim traveled for rodeos. She raised their four children, Jamie, Marvin, Jana, and Marcy, while running the ranch. Sharon also helped Jim start one of the first rodeo riding schools, becoming another mom for many of the young men who attended. Along with her lifelong friend Donna McSpadden, they founded Hands Group, an organization helping other women in the rodeo world with the personal challenges of raising a family and being alone. She also started one of the first Saloon herds in Oklahoma and was active in pioneering the heightening awareness of the lean beef movement. She led the Rodeo Historical Society and served on the board of the Oklahoma Historical Association and was a pillar of the First United Methodist Church of Henrietta, serving in almost every capacity. She was honored with the creation of the Professional Bull Riding Association's Sharon Shoulders Award, given annually to the wife of a bull rider who demonstrated grit, determination, and goodwill for her community. Oklahoma was lucky to have the California girl become an Okie transplant who wouldn't have lived anywhere else. To know them was to love them. Both believed in all we were doing here at the Cowboy, and we can't thank them enough for all their support through the years.
To help us honor their memory, I'd like to invite to the stage Jana Shoulders, Alice Foran, and the woman and I like to call Tater Tot, Reba McEntire.
You've heard it said, and so often it's true, behind a great man there's a good woman too. He had a great wife, Alice was her name. She helped him to ride the long road to fame.
Okay, now try to talk after that.
Well done.
Thank you. Well, that was a verse from a song about our grandpap, John McEntire, and the woman was Alice Hayhurst McEntire. She was a school teacher, and she stayed at home and took care of the ranch, the place, taught school, and raised their one and only son, Clark, while John went on to become the 1934 world champion steer roper. That song was from the Ballad of John McEntire. And keep on going just a little bit more. I'm through with that one. Keep going. I've already said that. Here we go. I wish I could have just pulled that off and memorized it all, but anyway. The wives of rodeo cowboys are very similar to the wives of entertainers, musicians on the road, the road crew who go out on tours to entertain folks around the world. And it's the very blessed traveler who has someone at home to keep things going, taking care of the kids and the livestock and the ranch. The two women we are recognizing tonight did just that. Sharon Shoulders, wife of Jim Shoulders, seven-time world champion all-around cowboy, and Jacqueline McEntire, wife of three-time world champion steer roper Clark McEntire. And while we recognize these two women, they represent thousands of women over many decades of rodeo cowboys going out on the road to compete, bringing home their prize money to pay the grocery bill, make a payment at the bank so they could buy more land or cattle. Sharon and Mama represent the other half of the team that was very seldom recognized or given any credit to. So let's recognize them all tonight. Let's honor the women who dedicated their lives to support their men, their family, and the sport of rodeo. Let's stand up and give them a big rip-roaring round of applause.
Man, I think we should leave after that. I don't even want to come up here now. I just want to say a sincere thank you to Jackie and Sharon and their families who were in attendance tonight. They've come a long way, so thank you guys for being here. And man, that was cool. All right, let's kick it off. Welcome to the stage. Let's back up again, can we? Let's kick things off. And welcome to the stage, Oklahoma grown actor. Wait a minute. All right, she's grown, and she's from Oklahoma, and she's an actor. So she's an Oklahoma grown actor and writer, Rachel Cannon, with museum board member and granddaughter of legendary Western actor John Wayne, Anita LaCava Swift.
First this time, not halfway through the show. Okay. Yesterday, as Rex said, we presented the literary and the music awards, and it was fabulous. Well, one of our authors, Nathan Dahlstrom, talked about the fact that his daughter was missing her homecoming court that night to support her father. I mean, if that isn't Western, I don't know what is, right? Well, we got some amazing news last night. Livvy, will you stand up? She wasn't able to be at her homecoming. She's back there. But she won. She's our homecoming queen. She deserved applause from a lot of people. Okay, we're going to kick it off now, huh, Rachel?
Let's do it.
Okay. Thanks to the generous support of Lance and Linda Benham, who help us with our first Wrangler presentation in the field of television and film for Outstanding Western Lifestyle Program.
In this program, Oklahoma's OETA crew of nationally recognized visual storytellers invites viewers on a journey from Texas through Oklahoma, pushing cattle on the Chisholm Trail to the railheads in Kansas. These ain't no slitty slickers.
The romantic image of the Old West, of cattle drives and trail hands riding the range, has captured imaginations for over a century. The main artery of that dream runs right through the middle of Oklahoma. The Chisholm Trail is the most famous of many trails that brought hundreds of thousands of head of cattle from Texas through Oklahoma to the railheads in Kansas. The great trail drives are long gone, replaced by cattle trucks on the road to auction.
So it was a very long agreement, but they all shook hands and said, yes, let's move forward. And overnight, this industry was born in Oklahoma City.
The demand for beef is greater than ever and continues to drive the billion-dollar economy of Oklahoma's Cowtown.
The Wrangler Award for Outstanding Western Lifestyle Program goes to Robert Birch and Ryan Lorg for Cowtown.
Thank you. Our show is about the Chisholm Trail, as you can see, and what it transformed into in the modern age. Growing up in Oklahoma City, I guess I always thought the Chisholm Trail was somewhere way out west, you know, probably because the movies always made the cattle drives look like they were in California. There was always snow-capped mountains in the distance. Well, there's no snow-capped mountains in Oklahoma or Texas. The Chisholm Trail is just 35 miles west of here, really. Today, they call it Highway 81. It stretches from South Texas through the sea of grass and Indian Territory to the railhead up in Kansas. Now, moving the Longhorn cattle north looked a whole lot less like rawhide and a lot more like John Wayne and the Cowboys. The age was 18 the average, and around 30 days on the trail of scorpions, rattlesnakes, unpredictable weather, and rustlers of every stripe trying to shave a few head off the herd. It was so dangerous that very few cowboys made more than one trip, but the 10 years of trail drives so captured the imagination that we're still dreaming. I'd like to thank the National Cowboy Western Heritage Museum, the PBS, and Oklahoma Public Television Authority for providing a near-perfect forum to tell these stories. I'd like to thank our Executive Director, Polly Anderson, our Vice President of Production, Susan Cadeau, and my partner in production, Mr. Ryan Lord. It's just the two of us. He shoots and edits, and I do the research and write the scripts. As long as the wide open spaces live in our hearts, the West will always be wild. Thank you.
Tonight's first induction into the Hall of Great Westerners is sponsored by the National Western Stock Show. A cowboy's cowboy and prince among men, Ben Houston was known for his calm, soft-spoken leadership that inspired real respect amongst his peers. Let's hear more about this incredible legacy of this inductee.
Bennett Ben Richard Houston showed his first calf in 1938 as a 9-year-old schoolboy. This was the start of his American dream, to have a cattle ranch, a family to nurture, a good horse to ride, and a chance to give something back for the opportunity of fulfilling a dream. In 1950, he married Anita Lambert. Together they had 4 children. Houston was founder and owner of Aristocrat Angus Ranch in Platteville, Colorado, and was a nationally renowned registered Angus seed stock producer. He's been recognized among many outstanding organizations, including being named Citizen of the West from the National Western Stock Show, a Saddle and Sirloin Club Portrait Gallery inductee, and a Colorado Agricultural Hall of Fame inductee. He also received the Colorado Angus Association Pioneer Breeder Award. He was chairman, vice chairman, president, and visionary of the Western Stock Show Association. He was director of the Roundup Riders of the Rockies. He also proudly served in the U.S. Air Force during the Korean conflict. Houston left a legacy of a lifetime commitment to the livestock industry of the Rocky Mountain West, past, present, and future.
Please join me in honoring Ben Houston with his induction into the Hall of Great Westerners. His award is being accepted by his son, Skyler Houston.
Thank you. My father, Ben R. Houston, would truly be humbled by his induction this evening for being nominated to the Hall of Fame of Great Westerners at the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum. He and my mom, Emma, Nita, to her friends and family, had a tremendous love and dedication for their family, which are here with me this evening. He had a love and was a true citizen of the West. His passion and involvement in the Western Stock Show Association developed from exhibiting livestock to helping lead the organization as president and later chairman emeritus. I'd like to recognize those here from the Western Stock Show Association, Pat Grant, past president and chairman emeritus, Paul Andrews, president and CEO, board member Pete Coors. I hope they were serving Coors beer here this evening, and Angelina Louis. I hope I got that right, Angela. Dad had a passion for the West and its spectacular beauty. He was a passionate rider with the Roundup Riders of the Rockies, and I'd like to extend a special thanks to John Roten, who was instrumental in helping Dad be nominated this evening. I'd also like to thank other Roundup Riders that are here with us. On behalf of the Houston family and all of Dad's wonderful friends and family, we thank you from the bottom of our hearts.
Governor Bill Anitubby from the Chickasaw Nation is one of tonight's generous supporters. He helps us honor Johnson as our next inductee into the Hall of Great Westerners. Please welcome Governor Bill Anitubby.
Thank you. His father, we're talking about Montford Johnson, was an English actor. And his mother was a member of the Chickasaw Nation. And Mr. Montford Johnson struggled most of his life with chronic illness. But that didn't stop him from becoming one of the West's most prolific ranching entrepreneurs, an honored member of the Chickasaw Nation, and even a trusted friend to legendary Jesse Chisholm. Let's hear more about this extraordinary pioneer.
An entrepreneur and cattle rancher, Montford T. Johnson was born in November 1843 along the Blue River north of Tishomingo in what is now Johnston County, Oklahoma. Raised by his maternal grandmother's family after his mother's death and his father's desertion, Johnson grew up to build a ranching empire in central Oklahoma. Johnson established cattle ranches on the unruly western edge of the Chickasaw Nation. In 1868, Johnson created his first ranch and hired a Chickasaw freedman, Jack Brown, to run and share the operation. This was the first of many business ventures manned by non-whites that flourished under Johnson's leadership. Over the next 25 years, Johnson expanded his operations and was running cattle as far west as present Hydro, Oklahoma in the late 1880s. He left this world in 1896 in Minco, Oklahoma. Through his ranch expansions and 12 children, Johnson played a positive role in the growth of the Chickasaw Nation.
Accept the award for Mr. Johnson's induction into the Hall of Great Westerners is the great-grandson, Eddie Edwards.
Thank you so much, Governor. I'm not going to let the governor leave the stage just yet because there are two things I'd like to mention tonight. The governor's been very, very busy today and yesterday. The new museum, the First Americans Museum, is opening today, I understand. A 40-year labor of love, a commitment. 39 of the tribes have now jumped on the bandwagon with Governor Anitubbi and his staff and his team, his administration. And we as Oklahomans, 175,000 feet, $175 million to build it. It would be a great, great thing for our state. Married right along beside this Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum, bookended on the north and the south side of Oklahoma City. What a great, great thing to talk about the Cowboys and the Indians in Oklahoma. Yes, my great-great-grandfather was Montford T. Johnson. He had 12 children, as they said on the video. One of his sons was Edward B. Johnson, who was my great-grandfather. And he had four boys and four girls. My grandfather was the youngest and born in 1902. Interestingly, all the Johnson boys, four boys and four girls, all the Johnson boys played football for Benny Owen there at OU. Quarterback, defensive back, ends, whatever. My grandfather never weighed more than 140 pounds playing football. It was way different than today. But those Johnson boys had all kinds of kids also, the women. My mother is here tonight. The other recognition I want to make, she had 16 cousins, first cousins, brothers and sisters, first cousins, and she is now, I'm not sure how to say the oldest or the eldest. I'm not sure which would be more appropriate for my mother. But she's here with us tonight, Elaine Johnson Edwards, our matriarch. Mother, would you stand up, please? At 95 years young, I was going to have Mother walk up here with me to the stage, but we have a full docket, and we might not be out here until tomorrow morning if we did that. So thank you very much to you guys, and we appreciate it very much. God bless.
You know, things are going south on me real quick. My Texas Longhorns are tied with Rice 0-0. And Raquel just told me backstage, the stagehand, she's amazing. She just said, you got a pretty cool tie, but you should be wearing mine because it's a lot better. And I looked at it, and it is. Nathan wouldn't let me bring her out here to show you, because I'm going to bring that tie out here, and I'm going to let you guys choose, because I'm thinking about getting rid of it, even though this is my favorite tie. Next, I'd like to welcome a dear friend of mine, and he's a fellow panhandler where I grew up in the Texas Panhandle. He's a musician, he's an actor, he's the greatest storyteller that ever lived, and he's past Hall of Great Westerners inductee, Red Steigall, accompanied by son of an Olympic gold medalist who's also a dear friend, and stuntman Dean Smith. Welcome Finest Smith and Red Steigall.
Thank you, Rex. Before we present this next award, we'd like to recognize an individual who's very near and dear to our hearts and someone I have the honor to call my friend.
My father has been a great supporter for this event and institution for as long as I can remember, from watching him being honored on this very stage to coming back year after year to present awards to many other distinguished individuals. Please share a round of applause in honoring my father, Dean Smith. Thank you for passing the torch, Dad.
A grand friend and a grand gentleman and a great athlete and a wonderful actor. The Wild West is still out there, and the popular PBS program Today's Wild West will show you how to find it. Thanks to our sponsor, Hughes Cattle Company, we're pleased to present our next Wrangler for Outstanding Western Lifestyle Program.
Featuring veteran rider and photographer Mark Bedore, this program takes the audience on the adventure through the West. Let's saddle up and take a look.
Up next on Today's Wild West, Montana's Hell's a Roaring Horse Drive, a great ride for a good cause.
You call me that, smile.
We'll take you to the California cattle ranch of one of Hollywood's biggest stars.
And I woke up one day and I thought, wow, we're covering California with asphalt.
And the California Rangeland Trust, working to save the ranches of the Golden State. Plus, we'll follow Custer's trail to the Little Bighorn. Today's Wild West, up next. The Wild West, it's still out there. And we'll show you how to find it. This is Today's Wild West.
Adding to his Wrangler collection, the award for Outstanding Western Lifestyle Program goes to Mark Bedore.
Thank you very much. To paraphrase the great Charlie Russell, a man can't take credit for a gift, and I honestly can't take credit for this gift. I want to thank my beautiful, patient, supportive, and hot wife, Marilyn, who has stood by me through thick and thin, my great post-production editor, Robert Hotz, and all the people who've allowed me to tell their stories. I do shoot, write, edit, and host Today's Wild West, but this is God's show, and the honor goes to him. He inspired it, he made it possible, and also his son, Jesus Christ, who rescued me from the self-destructive lifestyle I was living and still rescues me from myself to this very day. He took the threads of what I thought was a ruined life and opened my eyes to the great American West and then redirected the skills I'd learned in TV news to do this show, a labor of love that is the perfect fit for who I am. God told me in writing that if you follow my trail, I'll give you the desires of your heart. And I always wanted to be a cowboy, ever since I saw How the West Was Won back in third grade. And to receive this award from the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum is the greatest honor that this cowboy could ever receive. And so, I thank you. I thank you, I thank God, and thank God for the National Cowboy Museum and all it stands for.
In the late 1880s, J.R. Morse visited a ranch in Denton County and discovered a barefoot young man who worked harder than the grown ranch hands around him. Morse made an offer to the young man to join his ranch. I'll buy you a pair of boots and make a real cowboy out of you.
And so began the story of our next inductee to the Hall of Great Westerners. A son of enslaved people, he became one of the West's first black cowboys and greatest horse trainers. Legend has it he could tame any wild horse. And tonight we honor civic leader and cowboy, Matthew Bones Hooks.
Matthew Bones Hooks, cowboy and horse breaker, was born in 1867 to parents Alex and Annie in Robertson County, Texas. Hooks became one of the first black cowboys to work alongside whites as a ranch hand. Hooks took part in many trail drives to Kansas before 1886, his 19th year, when he helped to bring a herd to the young Texas panhandle town of Clarendon. He stayed there for 23 years and made a name for himself as a top horse wrangler in that part of the country before moving to Amarillo. Religion was very important to Bones, and he was instrumental in building the first black church in the panhandle. He was the first black man to sit on the Potter County Grand Jury and the first of his race to be a member of the XIT Association, the Montana Cowpunchers Association, the Western Cowpunchers, and the Pampa Old Settlers Association. He also created the Dogie Club for underprivileged boys. His generosity towards needy friends left him penniless near the end of his life, but friends established a fund for his care when word that he was ill became publicized. Bones Hooks Park in Amarillo was named for the black cowboy and civic leader that stands to this day in his honor.
To accept on behalf of Bones, would you welcome Alfonso and Linda Vaughn?
As a prelude before you start the teleprompter, I have to thank those that traveled from Amarillo with us to the celebration. Also, our anonymous donor who paid for us to have a seat, our mayor pro tem, and the Bynums all accompanied us from Amarillo. So if you would, just nod us out.
Matt, good evening. Matt.
And now, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Alfonso Vaughn, Potter County, Texas Commissioner, and my wife, Linda. On behalf of the County of Potter, the City of Amarillo, and the North Hikes Association, Community Association, it is our great honor to stand here tonight to accept this award posthumously for Matthew Bones Hooks. Mr. Hooks died 7 months before I was born, so I never had the opportunity to meet the man who was instrumental in the creation and development of the North Hikes community, in which both my wife and I were born and currently live. Bones Hooks, his wife Ann, had no children of their own, but he became a father figure through mentoring of black boys with the Dogie Club, established by him in 1932.
And just a couple of weeks ago, my husband and I stopped off at the grave of Matthew Bone Hooks and his wife, Ann, just to say, well done, cowboy.
Well done. Thank you to the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum for this wonderful award. Thank you.
To say our name. next inductee has enjoyed a prolific Western lifestyle is an understatement. Mel O. Potter continues his family's ranching legacy as a patriarch of Potter Ranch, one of the largest farming and ranching operations in the U.S.
At the age of 16, Mel proved himself an accomplished roper, joining the Professional Rodeo Cowboys Association. Almost 70 years later, he is known as one of the greatest rodeo stars in the world.
Thanks to our friends at Wagon Hound Land and Livestock Company for sponsoring this induction. Let's learn more about this lifelong cowboy.
Born in Wisconsin in 1935, Mel Potter grew up in Arizona and graduated from the University of Arizona in Tucson, where he competed in intercollegiate rodeo as an all-around champion for 4 years. During the late 1950s and 1960s, he competed in roping events throughout the West, winning events at Calgary, Cheyenne, Denver, Phoenix, and Tucson, and qualifying for the National Finals Rodeo. In 1964, he went into the stock contracting business as Rodeos, Inc. He also sent many rough stock animals to the National Finals Rodeo, including 5 NFR champion saddle and bareback broncs. A member of the Professional Rodeo Cowboys Association for more than 50 years, Potter also holds membership with the National Senior Pro Rodeo Association and the Senior Steer Ropers Association, the National Intercollegiate Rodeo Association alumni, Rancheros Vistadores, the Rodeo Historical Society, and served on the board of the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum. He is the owner of the Mel Potter Ranch and Driftwood Horses Limited. In 2005, Mel Potter was honored with the Ben Johnson Memorial Award by the Rodeo Historical Society.
And here to accept Mr. Potter's Wrangler is his daughter, 4 times WPRA World Barrel Racing Champion, Sherry Servi.
My dad is currently watching this on the Wrangler Network, so hey, Dad. The ordinary becomes extraordinary when done consistently. My father is being honored today for an ordinary life that created extraordinary results through hard work and consistency. It is a privilege and honor to accept this award for my father. He is overwhelmed with gratitude, even though he feels undeserving. I would like to thank the committee for giving my father this award, but also for giving us vision for the future. This committee helps recognize, document, and honor past and present individuals while influencing inspiring those ahead to reach new heights. There is something very grounding and fulfilling in what we do. Horses and land have the ability to transport us back into simpler times. It helps us remind us of our values and their importance. My dad was captivated by the Western lifestyle at an early age of 7, although we grew up in an agricultural family. After attending his first rodeo in Tucson, Arizona, he knew his heart would not let him pursue anything else. I am so grateful he followed his dreams, which paved the way for me to follow mine. Thank you so much for honoring and recognizing my dad.
All right, now here's the deal. It does look pretty good, but we're going to just a quick audience survey to see which one I'm going to wear. Okay, so see this one? This one's pretty cool. It's got a little whatever. It looks pretty cool. And then there's this one. There's this one. That really makes me mad, man. I guess I'll switch. Here to present the Wrangler for our next category, please welcome actor and producer Darby Hinton and singer-songwriter Eli Barcy.
Hey, what a great-looking group, I gotta say. Our next award in television and film is Outstanding Documentary, sponsored by Monte Carol, Montgomery Living Trust. Writer and producer Dayton Duncan, along with director Ken Burns, shares a comprehensive look at the history of country music through the 20th century. Let's look at a clip.
Everybody loves cowboys. And so whether they came from the hills of West Virginia or the piney woods of East Texas, they tended to wear cowboy boots and cowboy hats and sometimes give themselves cowboy names.
Singing cowboys and cowgirls were everywhere. And regardless of whether real cowboys had ever yodeled to their cattle herds during the trail drives of the 1800s, they all were yodeling now.
Every group of men who are isolated develop a song tradition. There are lumberjack songs, there are sailor shanties, and the cowboys did doubtless sing. Probably not nearly as much as it's shown in the westerns, or we're led to believe. Once Gene Autry made it really popular and building off the huge success of Jimmy Rogers, then every cowboy had to yodel.
The recipient for Outstanding Documentary is Country Music. Here to accept on their behalf is OETA's Robert Birch.
Me again. Ken Burns was very sorry he couldn't be here tonight, but he did send his regards, saying, country music is a uniquely American art form that tells a uniquely American story one song at a time. And the songs of the West, from Gene Autry to the Sons of the Pioneers, the Bob Wills, to Marty Robbins, George Strait, were all an important part of it. We at Florentine Films are excited to be able to bring that history to millions of viewers. And we're very honored to receive this award. We wish that we could be here with you tonight to thank you in person, and we hope that you'll stay tuned for a documentary that we'll be producing on PBS in a few years, telling the dramatic story of the American buffalo. Thank you. Sincerely, Ken Burns, Dayton Duncan, and Julie Dunphy.
Named after the museum's founder, the Chester A. Reynolds Memorial Award promotes honesty, humility, and integrity. I'm sorry, I gotta go off script here just for 1 minute because everything except for the humility part. And I wouldn't break and say this except for if I wasn't in the Citadel of Western Heritage in front of a whole room of beautiful cowboys and cowgirls, but I just want you to know and just pay homage just for a second to, we lost another great cowboy. We put him to rest today at 1 o'clock, but Don Collier took his last ride today. And I just have to say that since we're talking about all the cowboy morality and everything else, because I know he taught it to me through the High Chaparral and everything else. So here, and I know we've lost some great ones, but since he was laid to rest today, I just had to say that. So here's all the cowboys that we've lost. Hats off. Sorry, I had to do that or he'd come down and get me somehow. But I do want to thank Nadine and Alan Levin, who sponsored this award.
From ranching in Alberta, Canada, to the bright lights in Hollywood, this cowboy has seen it all. Let's get to know a little more about this man and his unwavering dedication to upholding Western values.
John Scott's ranching blood runs three generations deep, and the pride of heritage is evident in the careful preservation of his 100-year-old working ranch. Established by Scott's grandfather in 1904 and located in the ranching foothills of the Canadian Rockies, the ranch itself exudes authenticity. The Alberta ranch includes a cow-calf operation, horses, and a herd of bison. Scott maintains three movie sets on his ranch where they shoot films. Scott has worked on more than 100 movies and television shows since 1969. He has been a part of 7 Academy Award-winning pictures. His first film began with Little Big Man in 1969, featuring Dustin Hoffman and Chief Dan George. Following that production, Scott went to Hollywood and worked with the Wranglers and stuntmen, an invaluable experience when it came time for producers to come to Alberta. Many blockbusters followed, including Days of Heaven, Unforgiven, Legends of the Fall, and Jesse James. He has also worked on Hollywood hits like Shanghai Noon, Lord of the Rings, and The Revenant, Scott continues to bring the high-powered studios of California to his ranch to make Western films a reality.
Wow, we are so pleased for all that work and to present the 2020 Chester A. Reynolds Memorial Award to Mr. John Scott.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and honored guests. It's a great pleasure to receive this Chester A. Reynolds Award. I'd like to thank Nadine and Alan Libben and Mike Nicola, who nominated and supported me for this prestigious award. The heritage of this country was founded and settled with ropes and horses and a lot of hard work by our forefathers. The Western way of life, its history and traditions, is something I've always appreciated, respected, and strived to keep alive. And deep thoughts to our veterans that sacrificed so much that we're able to enjoy such a great lifestyle today. But our Western values and heritage that has been established are under attack by animal activists, PETA, and other fanatical groups that we have to work harder and unify to protect what our past generations have handed down to us. Currently, we're in uncertain times. We have to think outside the box how we're going to preserve our way of life and Western culture and values for the future. And this event is one of the best for doing that. The future of tomorrow is the youth of today. And we need to take time to educate and embrace their lives with livestock and animals through all ages and walks of life. Again, a big thank you to everyone that made it possible for me to be here. Much success to my colleagues. And thank you to the Hall of Fame for this wonderful event that keeps our traditions alive. Thank you.
$400. I'm not kidding. Ladies and gentlemen, here to perform the Wrangler award-winning song. Hats off to the Cowboy. Please welcome back Red Stinger.
Thank you. City folks think it's all over, that the cowboy has outlived his time. See, the cowboy is the image of freedom, the hard-riding boss of the range. His trade is a fair one, he fights for what's right, and his ethics aren't subject to change. Hats off to the cowboy, he's still riding tall, still saddled. He's a graphic reminder of the life that we love. He's showing us all how to ride. He's showing us all how to ride. He still tips his hat to the ladies. Let you water first at the pond. He believes a day's wages is worth a day's work, and his handshake and word are his bond. Hats off to the cowboy, he's still riding tall, still live by the cowpuncher code. That's respecting your neighbors you find. and toting your share of the load. And toting your share of the load. Hats off to the cowboy, he's still riding tall. Don't let him ride out of your sight. On the day he rides off in the sunset alone is the day that America dies. God, don't let America die.
Thank you.
Welcome the farmer's wife herself, entrepreneur and great-granddaughter of Oklahoma's favorite son, Will Rogers, Jennifer Rogers Echeverry, and Wrangler Award-winning musical artist, Trinity Seeley.
Okay. I think you should do it.
I think you should do it.
I don't know if I can do it.
No.
I can try. I really think you should be the one to do it.
We should just do it together.
You want to do it together?
Let's do it together.
Okay, let's do it. Hi,
hey, George.
I'm sorry. I'm going to get fired, but we had to do it.
Okay, you got it.
So, sorry.
We got to get it together.
Okay. All right. That was actually a lot worse than I thought it was going to be because it was so awesome. Okay, get together. A special thanks to our NVC Oklahoma sponsoring our next Wrangler presentation with tonight's second Outstanding Documentary Award. Western author Charlie Russell's Stories on the Page immortalizes the larger-than-life mythos of what it meant to be a cowboy throughout the American West.
Award-winning filmmakers and co-producers Paul Zalis and Gus Chambers perfectly captured the life and times of this great cowboy artist. Here's just a glimpse of their work.
He showed something to the world that was very rare and precious and only here for a short time. He captured it, old Charlie Russell.
He wasn't quite famous as an artist yet, although in Montana, pretty much everybody knew who the cowboy artist was. He signed his name on his art and his illustrated letters, C.M. Russell. But everyone just called him Charlie.
A big round of applause for Wrangler winners Paul Zalis and Gus Chambers.
Charlie Russell once said he had friends when he had nothing else. For Charlie, it was simple. Friends were the most important thing in his life, and I know what he meant. The trail we followed to make our film about Charlie Marion Russell brought me a wagon train of new and now treasured friends. Thanks to Montana PBS for its unwavering support and to all the wonderful friends and organizations who made this film possible. And especially tonight, a special thanks, of course, to the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum. Thank you.
I guess I'm going to have to be the first guy to say this tonight, and I'm sure he's heard it before, but George, I don't know where you're at, but I'm wearing a pair of your pants. It was 35 degrees below zero this winter on the Montana High Line, and I was down in the basement nursing a dying furnace. Every 90 minutes, I was down there performing this ritual that involved a vacuum cleaner, surgical tubing, and an emery cloth. And it was then that I learned that Paul and I would share the Wrangler Award. So I paused more than a few moments, looked up at the floor joists, to reflect that this honor, this recognition, and tonight this august company would become one of the most treasured memories of my life. And then I went back to fixing the furnace. So I'll never forget that afternoon, and I'll never forget this evening. Thank you.
All right, well, that didn't go over so well because obviously Mr. Strait has left his table. So either I'm going to stand here and wait for him to come back, or he is going to have to come to our table and say hello to us. So we'll go ahead and move on.
And now, our second recipient of the Chester A. Reynolds Award goes to a true Western Renaissance man. Thanks to Monte Carol Montgomery Living Trust for sponsoring this special honor.
R.W. Hampton's music is able to connect to music lovers from all walks of life due to his genuine nature and his appreciation of all those who put in a hard day's work. R.W. began his cowboy career as a wrangler in New Mexico and has become not only an accomplished film actor and playwright, but one of the defining voices of today's Western music scene.
Let's get to know more about this versatile performer.
R.W. Hampton is one of the leading Western entertainers in America today. Having started out as a working ranch cowboy, R.W. is now known as today's voice of cowboy music. Blessed with a wonderfully rich baritone voice, R.W. has a quality of genuineness about him that resonates when he's on stage, on screen, in person, or just through the words of his songs. R.W. has 14 albums to his credit over the past 30 years. His peers in the entertainment industry have honored R.W. 17 times, including 3 Western Heritage Wrangler Awards and being inducted into the Western Music Association's Hall of Fame. R.W. has appeared in ads on radio, TV, print, and billboards, and over a dozen Western movies. You may also recognize his voice on commercials and several exhibits and videos here at the Cowboy Hall. One of R.W.'s most creative efforts is the one-man musical stage play, The Last Cowboy, written with his brother Jeff and playwright Dave Marquis. Today, R.W. and his wife split their time between Amarillo, Texas, and their Clearview Ranch at the foot of the Sangre de Cristo Mountains near Cimarron, New Mexico. His life is guided by his faith, his love for his family and country, and his desire to share the cowboy life with his audiences.
Please welcome our 2021 Chester A. Reynolds Award, our dear friend, recipient R.W. Hampton.
Thank you all. What a night. Rex would not let me borrow his broom. And I'm a little miffed about that, so I just had to come out here as me. But and he wouldn't loan me his tie, either one, so here we go. But many thanks to the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Center for this wonderful award. I also want to thank someone else, and that is the Wrangler Network. Yes. Big hand for him, please. Thanks to them, my parents in Richardson, Texas, and my in-laws up in Bend, Oregon are getting to watch this tonight. And so Mom and Dad, Ted and Kelly, I'm here. I was looking on the criteria for this award, and you got to be living. And so, you know, I got all dressed up before my wife kicked me out of the room, and so she could get dressed up. And I went one last time, and I breathed on the mirror. And I could just see that I was still alive, so. I'm so thankful tonight to have my 6 kids here with me. Yes, all 6 of them. When the sun sets on my trail, my greatest legacy will be my kids and my friends. and you know who you are. Thank you for coming. You know, I started out my adult life as a hired man on horseback. I was a cowpuncher. That's what I learned how to do. And I learned from the old ones, the viejos, old cowpunchers, that old World War II and Korean War vets that had worked for the JAs and the Swenson outfit and the Matadors and all those great ranches, and they took me under their wing, and they're all gone now. But I'm so thankful to have gotten to ride with those men. And I, yes. You know, Don, I guess it's up to you and me now, buddy. We're the old ones, the old viejos. But I taught my boys, all of them, they've gone different directions, a lot of them. But that's okay. We raised them on the ranch, and my daughter as well. And they learn how to do chores and break horses and do everything it takes to do that. And but you know what? I live that life. I live the life that most men had ever dreamed of. And if that's all I had ever done, and if I cashed in doing that, I'd have left this world a winner. But then music came along, and I had a whole nother group of men who mentored me musically. Charlie Daniels and David Corlew, Ian Tyson, Don Edwards, Michael Martin Murphy, and Reba. We got one of the same musical dads, and that's Red Steagall. You went a little further than I did. But that's okay. You know, I asked her a couple of years ago, my great-grandma on my dad's side was a McIntyre, but she was born on the south side of the Red River. Well, back in Kiowa, Oklahoma, that's almost like being cousins, I think, you know. Well, after music came along, then motion pictures and advertisements and so forth, and I got a whole new bunch of mentors like Ben Johnson, Dick Farnsworth, Buck Taylor, and Dave Cass. And they taught me how to be on screen and hit my mark and say a few words, and I really appreciated that. I mean, you can't be in a better class of men to learn that trait from, I'll tell you. But I'm really nostalgic tonight, and my mind goes back to my old cowpunching days. And I'm often asked two different questions. What is your favorite cowboy and western ballad? Because I've kind of become known as a fellow that sings cowboy songs. And the other question is, if you could only sing one song in the whole wide world, what would it be? Well, now both those questions are easy to answer, because it's just one song will answer both those. And I'm going to tell you what it is here in a minute. It comes from riding out with a bunch of good men, maybe 12 to 15 men. You're hitting a long trot, and it's October shipping time in the West, roundup time. And you're riding out with a bunch of good men, and nobody's saying much. It's blacker than the inside of a cow, as J.B. Allen would have said. About all you can see is an iron-shod hoof turning over a rock every now and then, or a Prince Albert cigarette in a cowpuncher's lips. And then it gets a little bit lighter, and you're jogging along there, and the boss starts calling out names. And you call out a cowpuncher's name, and he'll turn and ride off and go to gathering cattle. And then you ride about another quarter of a mile or half a mile, and he'll drop off another man. And you go a little further and a little further, and finally, the boss calls out your name. It's just like the spokes of a wagon wheel heading down to the hub, and you're throwing all those cattle together in a roundup. So you're there by yourself, and you watch the cow crew right out of sight. You step off your horse, loosen your cinch, reset your saddle, and before you step back on, the sun breaks on the horizon, and the whole world's lit up, and you're seeing the birth of a brand new day. You can see every butte, every canyon. You can see the Canadian River, the way it winds its way through the countryside, and the golden cottonwoods down there. And at that moment, you know that there's no finer place to be on earth than where you are right now. There's no band, there's no orchestra. It's just you, a good horse, and God Almighty. Thank you. Not yet, mister. And I don't know any greater song that would come to the heart of a man, or the heart of this man, would be this song. Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hands have made. Lord, I see your stars, and I hear your rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Thank you.
Welcome to the stage, board member and Traditional Cowboy Arts Committee Chair, Mike Nicola.
Wow, I've got my own little cheerleading squad down here. What a just a wonderful night. I think everybody's just so darn happy to be together in this great place, right? And I want to echo some of the other comments. I just want to thank the staff. Natalie and the entire crew here, man, tough conditions, great job, great job. For those of you, this is your first time here, I hope you're excited enough to come back. We'd love to see you again, right? Amen. At this time, we'd like to recognize an elite group of individuals who have a deep and continuing passion for the sharing of the West through authentic working gear of the cowboy. They have elevated it to fine art. This year, they have crafted two very special buckles for tonight's Lifetime Achievement Award recipients, Robert Duvall and George Strait. They really are spectacular. We present our Special Director's Choice Award to the Traditional Cowboy Arts Association, sponsored by Mr. and Mrs. Craig Kirshner. Let's learn a little bit more about this prestigious organization.
In 1998, a group of the West's leading cowboy artisans, saddle makers, silversmiths, rawhide braiders, and bit and spur makers recognized a threefold crisis: a shortage of newcomers entering their trades, an aging master class of artists, and fewer opportunities for apprentices to find willing and qualified mentors. In response, these individuals joined together to form the Traditional Cowboy Arts Association, a nonprofit organization dedicated to educating student craftsmen by demonstrating the levels of quality possible in their respective trades. The association established scholarships and annual workshops, enabling craftsmen to travel and experience hands-on instruction and mentoring from some of the recognized masters in their respective disciplines. More than 2,000 Western craftsmen and students have benefited from the TCAA. Starting in 1999, in partnership with the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum, the association's members began producing an individual one-of-a-kind pieces for an annual exhibit and sale held each fall at the museum. With 23 years of history under their belts and the creation of over 900 unique pieces of art with a cumulative value of over $10 million, the TCAA is helping hold on to the West.
Wow. Huh? Simply taking a dying craft and elevating it to art. By the way, their show is in 2 weeks, right here, October 1st and 2nd. You are all invited. Come on down. Please join me in honoring the Traditional Cowboy Art Association. Accepting the Director's Choice Award is one of the organization's founding members, saddle maker, Mr. Kerry Schwartz.
First of all, thank you to Natalie Shirley and the staff here at the museum. What a fabulous evening you provided for us and an entire 2 days that we've enjoyed here. So a number of years ago, we were given some musical advice that I think you'll all remember. It went something like this: you've got to have an ace in the hole. So here we are at the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum at the Western Heritage Awards. And we ask, what is our ace in the hole? And the answer is obvious, isn't it? We've all decided somewhere along the way that our Western heritage is worth hanging on to. And thanks so much to this great institution and all who have helped us engage in the battle to keep our Western heritage relevant and robust. On behalf of the Traditional Cowboy Arts Association, a heartfelt thank you for this tremendous honor. Thank you very much.
Please welcome to the stage actor and 2017 Hall of Great Western Performer inductee, Patrick Wayne, and youngest child of the Duke himself, Marisa Wayne.
Our first Wrangler in the category of Outstanding Theatrical Motion.
Beautiful.
Thank you. Outstanding Theatrical Motion Picture is sponsored by Mr. and Mrs. Dan Lindstrom and Mr. and Mrs. David Bishop. The trick of a good Western film is to capture the catharsis of a good story against the expansive backdrop of the Great West while elevating small intimate moments shared around a campfire. The 2020 film News of the World is a perfect example of all of these elements working in concert.
The most talented Tom Hanks is joined by newcomer German actress Helena Zengel to tell this epic tale. Here is a clip from News of the World.
I'm getting a call. See all those words? Put them all together. You have a story.
Story.
Captain, why are you doing this? little girl is lost. I'm returning her to her surviving family.
Well, you can certainly handle a horse.
Horse.
That's right.
Captain.
Make no mistake, Captain. Road's closed. Is that the law?
It is now.
How much you want for her?
She's not for sale.
The stories on these pages can't get us home.
No, hurry up! She was dying for!
You can't have her! And I'm taking her home!
It's hard. Find a new way.
News of the World. In theaters Christmas.
Well, maybe. Yeah. It was good. We, Maurice and I, are honored to accept this Wrangler for the Outstanding Motion Picture for News of the World.
Thanks to our sponsor, Timmerman Land and Cattle, for helping us honor our next inductee into the Hall of Great Westerners.
Woodrow Wilson Woolwine Strode, better known as Woody Strode, broke barriers as one of the NFL's first black athletes. However, his stanza in the story of the West took a path of even higher greatness by becoming one of Hollywood's most prolific actors when he met legendary film director and my godfather, John Ford. You have no doubt enjoyed him in work in such epic films as The Ten Commandments, Spartacus, Sergeant Rutledge, to some of the great Western tales committed to film like Once Upon a Time in the West, Two Rode Together, and The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance.
Here is just a glimpse of this great American actor's life.
Woodrow Wilson Woolwine Strode was an American athlete and actor. Strode was born in Los Angeles, but had Native American heritage through his grandmother, a black Cherokee, and his grandfather, a black Creek Indian. Strode was a decathlete and football star who was one of the first black American players in the National Football League in the post-war era. Strode, along with Kenny Washington and Jackie Robinson, starred on the 1939 UCLA Bruins football team. Strode was drafted at age 27 and soon joined the United States Army Air Corps. He spent the war in Guam and the Marianas. Following the war, he signed briefly to the Los Angeles Rams along with Kenny Washington. After football, Strode went on to become a film actor. Strode made his first appearance in Sundown in 1941, playing a native policeman. Strode's acting career was reactivated when producer Walter Mirisch spotted him wrestling and cast him as an African warrior in The Lion Hunters. Later, he was nominated for a Golden Globe Award for Best Supporting Actor for his role in Spartacus in 1960. Sheriff Woody of the Toy Story series of animated films is named after Strode, a unique homage to Strode's memorable character acting.
It is our honor to accept this Wrangler on behalf of Woody as we induct him into our Hall of Great Westerners. Help us honor his achievements with a round of applause.
Okay, you do it. No, 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 you do it. Hi, Reba. Thank you. I don't know where this came from. I asked him for my broom back. This apparently is a cousin of the broom. I kind of like it, so we're just going to leave it here for a minute. Here to present our next award for Outstanding Theatrical Motion Picture, please welcome to the stage actors and Hall of Great Western Performer inductees Bruce Boxleitner and Burke Orban.
You know, Bruce, a fella came up to me last night over there at that cocktail party.
Mm-hmm.
Says to me, Barry Corbin, I'm so glad you're not dead. Well, my first thought was to, my answer was a lamb too. But then I thought, well, why would he say that? He said, when I heard about this COVID thing, and they did away with the awards for last year, I thought you would die. And I said, no, I'm sorry to disappoint you. I ain't dead. I almost was. I hid in my house like a troglodyte for a year and a half. I worked 2 days last year. Whenever I was desperate for company, I'd get in my car, punch an address into the GPS and drive, and then I'd do a U-turn, and the GPS would say to me in the sarcastic tone of Eve Arden in her most sarcastic parts, and turn around and go to the route, dummy. And I would do that, and I'd be satisfied for a while, and then a call would come in and said, this call is being recorded for quality control. And I was delighted because somebody was listening to me. That's the way last year went. And then every time I'd go talk to a group of people, I thought I was talking to a convention of bank robbers. They were all masked up. I was scared to go to the bank. I was afraid the ATM was going to arrest me. Anyhow, we are here.
Yes, and I'm glad and you're not back. Dead, brother.
I'm glad I'm not dead, too. Go ahead and talk a while.
The many fans of the HBO series Deadwood, oh yeah, were introduced to a gritty, unforgiving version of the West where lawless fiends coincided with brighter versions of character and honor, all living in a tiny gold rush town of Deadwood, South Dakota.
2019's Deadwood, the movie, finally gave a grateful audience an ending to the many stories and struggles of the souls living in this metamorphic embodiment of the West. Special thanks to our sponsor, Monte Carol Montgomery Living Trust. Here's a glimpse of Deadwood, the movie.
This town is a sanctuary. Every man worth the name knows the value of being unreachable.
It'd be a pity not to recognize what's at stake.
What's the move, Al?
You ever think, Bullock, of not going straight at a thing?
No.
We are proud to accept this Wrangler for Outstanding Theatrical Motion Picture for Deadwood, the movie. Thank you. Our thanks going to Mike and Sheila Ingram and Delora A. and Lester J. Norris Foundation, and to support our next honoree for Lifetime Achievement Award. If we were to list just the career highlights of our 2020 Lifetime Achievement Award recipient, we'd be here until next week. I bet if we quoted some of our favorite lines this legendary actor has aptly delivered, you could easily guess who we're talking about.
The only healthy way to live a life is to learn to like a little bit of everything, everyday things, like a sip of good whiskey in the evening, a soft bed, a glass of buttermilk, or a feisty gentleman like myself.
Yeah. A Lonesome Dove fan, huh? Yeah. Okay, how about this one? Smell it? Do you smell it? I love the smell of mint napalm in the morning. Smells like victory.
Too easy.
thought I was good.
It's all out war. We go to the mattresses.
Godfather?
Yeah, that's right.
Is that it? Yeah. For over seven decades, Robert Duvall not only has played pioneers on the silver screen, but is himself a pioneer of the very craft of acting, earning him an Academy Award, four Golden Globe Awards, a BAFTA Award, two Primetime Emmy Awards, a Screen Actors Guild Award, and whew, the list just keeps going on and on.
Well, let's learn a little more about this prolific actor.
Robert Duvall is an American actor and filmmaker whose career spans more than seven decades. Duvall majored in drama at Principia College, then served a two-year hitch in the Army after graduating in 1953. In 1955, he began attending the Neighborhood Playhouse School of the Theater in New York City on the G.I. Bill, studying under Sanford Meisner along with Dustin Hoffman. Both were close to another struggling young actor at the time named Gene Hackman. The three have since earned among themselves 19 Academy Award nominations with five wins. Duvall was memorable as the heavy who was shot at the climax at True Grit and was the first Major Frank Burns creating the character in Altman's Korean War comedy, MASH. It was perhaps his appearance as Lieutenant Colonel Kilgore in Apocalypse Now that solidified Duvall's reputation as a great actor. He got his second Academy Award nomination for the role and was named by the Guinness Book of World Records as the most versatile actor in the world. Duvall created one of the most memorable characters ever essayed on film and gave the world the memorable phrase,
"I love the smell of napalm in the morning."
His greatest achievement in his immediate post-Oscar period was his triumphant characterization of the grizzled Texas Ranger Gus McCrae in the TV miniseries Lonesome Dove, for which he received an Emmy nomination. Through many beloved roles in theater, television, and film, Robert Duvall will long be remembered as one of the great naturalistic American screen actors of our time.
It's our honor. There he is.
Great to be here. Thank you so much. Great to be here anywhere at my age. But, hey, listen, the English have Shakespeare, the French have Molière, and the Russians have Dostoevsky. What do we own? What do we have? The Western. Let me hear you say it. Let me hear you say it. The Western, yeah, great. I mean, we own the Western, you know, and through literature, through singing, through movies, through television, through word of mouth, it's part of our heritage, and we own it. We definitely own the Western, and I think the seeds were sown for me in northern Montana years ago at the end of the. You know, end of the World War II, I was just a kid. And my brothers and I, the two of us, we spent two summers on my uncle's cattle ranch in northern Montana in the Sweetgrass Hills, overlooking the Milk River into Canada. And it was a great, great experience, a great learning experience. And my uncle, he taught us and he gave us chores and made us work. It was terrific. And there's a guy named, he had a wonderful cowboy cowhand who lived there, who had been born in Scotland and had wanted to be a cowboy all his life, reading books as a young man, and then they immigrated to America, Jimmy Morrison, and they ended up in Montana, and when he was of age, he became a working cowboy. My uncle had ranches from Idaho to Montana, and said Jimmy Morrison was the greatest natural horseman, ranch hand that he had ever had. He knew more. He was a natural veterinarian. The professionals couldn't get his secrets. He would go once a year to Shelby and win the calf roping. Then he'd come back and do his duties and chores. And he was a terrific horseman, par excellence and everything on that ranch. And a great inspiration to us as my brothers as young kids, you know. And, I remember one time he was very offhand in his lifestyle, even though he always did the work. I saw him rope a baby coyote one time. He had a terrific quarter horse, and one time he galloped full speed. We saw him across, and up, and he touched an antelope on the neck. And of course, those things really impressed young guys like me and my brother. It was terrific. And he was a wonderful, wonderful man. Of course, we pitched horseshoes every night after work. And of course, he couldn't swim. That's the only thing he couldn't do, or any of those cow hands. But, and every once in a while, he'd get a little too much liquor and get amorous towards my aunt. And my uncle would say, "Now, Jimmy, back off, okay, And they used to go up to Whitlash every Saturday night and to have a dance, but it never ended well because somebody would ask the wrong woman to dance, and it always ended in a big fist fight. So Jimmy, he lived on, and we went across country, me and my brother and his wife, a few years after that, and I went up to him in Chester, Montana, in the feedlot. He had retired by then. And I said, "You remember me? I'm Harold Prescott's nephew." He said, "Well, by God, you're not." And then it was great. And then we went on, and I never heard from him again or saw him again. But the thing is, people like that, you say, erroneously, I think that there'll be no more Jimmy Morrisons. But that's not true. Because right down the road was Buster Welch. And I told Buster Welch about Jimmy, But Buster was, Buster, you all know Buster, what a legend. Two-time world cutting horse champion, and four or five times futurity champion. And he ran the King Ranch. He taught others what he knew. And he's not like a lot of Texans I know with a bad language. He was wonderful. I like his humor and his inference about things. He would say a cowboy should ride up, pull up, and shut up. That was Buster Welch. And and then down in Utopia, Texas, the Lou Waters family, wonderful people. His daughter, Christy, and his son, Mike Goodyear from Oklahoma. They raise wonderful horses. She's a world-class polo player. And they had a stallion named Wild Card that they very graciously let us put in two movies. It was very, very wonderful of them to do that. And they're a great family and great, and I say this because I don't know if I could ever have been a rancher, but it's my duty. The onus is upon me to represent in my acting in films as accurately as possible this lifestyle. Whether or not I could have ever been a rancher, I don't know, but I have to, emulate it as best I can. And then there are the Buse brothers in Canada in a project I did. It was one of my favorite projects, Broken Trail, that Alan Jeffrion wrote. Yeah. And the Buse boys gave me a wonderful horse, just a wonderful, wonderful horse to ride, a big gray, quarter horse. And I rode more horseback in that movie than any movie I've ever done. And he was such a great horse, he'd do nothing to hurt you. At the end, he gave the horse to his 8-year-old daughter, and the Views boys went up to win shortly after that, the national champion Working Ranch Rodeo. Terrific people, terrific people. So anyway, I've had an interesting career that I've done a lot of lemons, but I think I've done some good work too, my wife and I, we drive around a lot, whether in Florida or Virginia where we live or wherever, and she's from northern Argentina, but she loves this country. She's a citizen now. And we drive home, and you always find people that by accident you bump into people that that have seen your work, and you're very appreciative of that people appreciate what you do. And we had gone up to the Perini Steak Ranch up in Buffalo Gap. I don't know if you've ever been there, but go. It's Billy Bob Thornton's favorite restaurant, and Waylon Jennings used to pull up in a bus, and all the musicians and the singers would get off and chow down on wonderful steaks and hamburgers finished off with whatever, just wonderful food. And also on Sunday morning, big buckets of golden fried chicken. It's just a wonderful, and we had done this once. So a couple of years later, let's do it again. We'll go up and see Tom and Mr. and Mrs. Perini. So we started out as we had done a few years before that. And we got to around Waco, and there was a new highway that was put in. It was just put in. I said, well, why don't we just go down this way? And so Luciana said, yeah, so let's try it. You know, it was like we owned it. Nobody had been, or maybe it was open like 2 days, but that's about it. So we're cruising along like 20 miles an hour, but we're really going 80 or 90. As Luciana comes from a family of race car drivers in northern Argentina. So now we're going along about 90, and here comes a state trooper. True story. Pulls us over. She puts the window down. He comes over, looks in the window, and says, ma'am, do you know you were going 90? He said, I don't believe this. He said, Lonesome Dove. Follow me. Follow me. So we went back to the original place where we had turned off. This is a true story. And he called the wife. She showed up with the two kids, and we talked. Nothing provincial about these people, wonderful people. And we talked, we took pictures, and it was lovely, you know, wonderful. So now, just as we said our goodbyes, he said, now this is the road that'll take you down to Buffalo Gap. This is the original road, you should take this. And I made a little joke. I said, now if I cross that state, those two lines, you're not gonna give me a ticket, are you? And without losing a beat, his wife said, well, if he does, he won't be allowed in my bed tonight. So we took off. So, yeah. But those are the wonderful, wonderful people you meet along the road, you know, and that you bump into. And it was terrific. But this is a terrific award tonight, and I wish my uncle was still alive to see. He lived long enough to see Godfather 1 in a theater, and right in the middle of it, he yelled out, I'd rather have a good Western, he yelled out. Yeah. But anyway, it's a wonderful evening, and it's great being, I always like being in the Southwest, love being in Texas, now Oklahoma. It's terrific, and thank you so much for this award, and God bless. Thank you.
That's something you don't see every day.
Yeah, that was pretty special. Pretty special.
We're pleased to recognize our next honoree in the achievement of outstanding fictional drama, sponsored by Dr. Tim and Mrs. Susan Love.
Lush and rolling landscape serves as the backdrop to the familiar scene of a timeless conflict in a modern setting in Paramount's drama, Yellowstone. Past Wrangler Award winner Kevin Costner heads the cast of this beautiful and at times brutal show that bloodies the Montana hillscapes, effortlessly wrapping audiences in this complicated modern Western. Here's a gander at Yellowstone.
Yep.
That's not mine.
It's addressed to you.
Wait, I don't know what that is. Don't! Casey!
Officer down! We got an officer down!
Jesus Christ.
Casey!
Don't you die on me now. Not like this.
You hear me?
Oh, my God.
What's happening?
I don't know. Just get to the bunkhouse.
Fair. Moral. Those are words men invented to scare and shame other men from taking back what they've stolen.
Oh, my God.
What about right or wrong? There's no such thing.
How you doing? Taylor Sheridan here from the set of 1883, and I just want to say thank you so much for recognizing Yellowstone. It's a pleasure to make and an honor to have you give it this award. So we all thank you, every one of us, and I guess we'll ride off into the sunset now.
Man, oh man. What award show is this? Where are we? First of all, Mr. Duvall, give it up, man. That is amazing. This has been one heck of a night, but we have one more very special honoree to recognize this evening. Presented by Codigo 1530 Tequila and Mr. Mark Linehan, our next Lifetime Achievement honoree's career spans more than 30 years with an astonishing 60 number one hits and over 33 platinum and multi-platinum albums. He's more than an impressive repertoire. Lovingly known to the fans around the planet as the king of country music, he sold millions of albums worldwide, making him one of the most recognizable and best-selling artists of all time. Here's a closer look at this country music troubadour.
George Strait is the unambiguous king of country music, having sold more than 84 million albums and counting while earning more than 60 major entertainment industry awards, as well as countless nominations and becoming the only act in history to have a top 10 hit every year for over three decades. With 33 different platinum or multi-platinum albums, he's earned the third most certifications of any artist in any genre, following only the Beatles and Elvis Presley, and with a total of 60, Strait has more number one songs than any other artist in history, including Elvis. Most recently, the Texas Troubadour released 2019's best-selling country album, Honky Tonk Time Machine, on MCA Nashville. Produced by Strait and Chuck Ainley, the album quickly became Strait's record-extending 27th number one Billboard country album. Comprised of 12 original titles, plus Strait's version of the Johnny Paycheck classic, Old Violin, Honky Tonk Time Machine marks an incredible 30th career studio album from the Country Music Hall of Fame member, who earned his 100th entry on the Billboard Country Airplay chart with his latest single, The Weight of the Badge. Since his record-breaking Cowboy Rides Away tour in 2014, Strait has performed for limited engagements, including three sold-out performances at the top of 2020, first with Visit Wichita Presents Straight to Oz at Intrust Bank Arena, then back-to-back nights of Straight to the Heartland at Kansas City's Sprint Center.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's give a special welcome to this year's Achievement Award honoree, Lifetime Achievement, Mr. George Strait.
You got to have an ace in the hole, a little secret that nobody knows. Life is a gamble, a game we all play, but you need to save something for rainy day. You've got to learn to play your cards right.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. It's an honor to be here. I want to thank everybody. I want to thank Mark Linehan. You told me about 5 or 6 years ago that you were going to work on this, and he's a man of his word. Here I am. Thank you so much. I'm here with my wife, Norma, and if we make it to December, that'll be 50 years. But it's day to day. Also, my son Bubba is here and his wife Tamara. And my friend Roy Cooper is here. Thanks for coming, Roy. Drove 3 hours to get here. My dad is beaming right now. I gotta get these notes out. I didn't know we had a teleprompter. I've seen sometimes they don't work that great anyway. But my dad, he's the one that taught me the ways of the cowboy life. And he was a cowboy. And he grew up in a little town called Big Wells, Texas, in South Texas. Probably when he was a kid, there was probably only about 150 people there. His mother was a school teacher, and his dad was a rancher. And so he grew up a cowboy. And so he kind of raised me and my brother. That was a tough job for him as a single dad. But he did all right. But anyway, he grew up and became a teacher and a rancher. And so all of the things that I learned from him, you know, on the ranch and what cowboys do, you know, and how they, you know, how you work, you know, there's no certain things you do. You do what needs to be done. You know, you do stuff to improve your land and you take care of it. It takes care of you were the things that he, you know, tried to teach me back then, and I still, you know, got a lot to learn. But I tried to, you know, take that Western heritage with me through my life and my career and, you know, pass it on to my family, my son and grandkids. And so it's fun to see them grow up that way. I want to tell you a funny story. When I first signed with MCA Records in 1981, you know, all the people were going, take the hat off. Now, can you imagine if I would have done that? I mean, really. And then I had a producer early on, and he was trying to get me to change my name to Kane Cooper. I would have been one of the Coopers. Me and old Roy would have been brothers. Well, we are brothers. But anyway, my dad was so glad I didn't do that. But so anyway, I want to thank everybody for this great honor. It really is truly a great honor for me. And I want to dedicate it, of course, to my dad. Thank you very much. Thank you.
I can't even say bye after that. I can't follow that up at all. Man, that's great. Can we give one more hand to Mr. Robert Duvall and George Strait for coming tonight, please? Congratulations to all the winners. This was number 60. Look forward to seeing you guys at 61. Drive safely. Hope you had fun. And grab your broom at home and get to know it. See you guys.